Hello and welcome to Trading Growth and Value Stocks. My name is James Boyd. We welcome you here. Alongside with me is my friend Lee Bull in the chat. You'll see his initials as LB. We welcome him here as well. We also have Kevin Florida, Debbie, Silas D, Eva, Lucky, Ray from Spain. My son, he lived in Spain, all over the place. He got to live in the Canary Islands, Salamanca, you know, Madrid, the whole nine yards. Great place. And Ray, we are jealous. Now, I got snow behind me, so hopefully wherever you are, it's not snowing. So I'm gonna, after this, I'm gonna go out there and help some of the people with their driveways after this. So I like to do that, actually. So let's go ahead and get started. We welcome everyone. Now, this class is on trading growth and value. Today, we're gonna be talking a little bit more about, well, we'll be talking more about value. Next week, we'll be talking about growth, as we'll show in just a second. Now, this is a series. We are on week 3 of 8. I'll show you where you can get the past 2 weeks in just a moment. Now, just real quick as we get started, remember the information here is for general informational purposes only, should not be considered a recommendation of individualized endorsements or a particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. Also understand that Schwab does not recommend the use of technical analysis as a sole means of research. This class, we talk about fundamental analysis. What is it that we're buying? And then also technical analysis, talking about the timing of it. We don't use one versus the other solely. We use them in combination, okay? Now, also remember when we talk about examples, we will be using the paper money software application known as the Thinkorswim software, okay? And also remember when we talk about examples, all investing involves risk, including loss of principal. And today we'll talk, we're going to be getting into, let me bring up this page right there. All right. So what you're going to notice is this is really the layout that we've actually been covering the last 2 weeks. So week one, we talk about understanding intrinsic value, and I will show you where you can see the playlist in just a moment. Price multiples and how they matter. We talked about that last week. And then this week, as promised, we're going to be talking about really a sample value investing plan. Okay, next week we'll be getting into a sample growth investing plan. Now, I want to stop for just a moment, and I want you to imagine you have $1 million, $2 million, $3 million, $4 million, etc. Okay, and the biggest thing is you might be thinking, well, now that I have that money, what am I going to do with it? It's not that you have it, it's what are you going to do with it, and how are you going to get a rate of return maybe for your lifestyle, right? So you might be thinking, well, if I had that $3 or $4 million, I wouldn't be investing. I'd just be over in Spain. Well, even if you were in Spain or wherever you are, the fact of the matter is you probably want your money to grow. At some point, all of us are going to break support or resistance, whichever one. I don't know what's going to happen, so we'll say both. But the biggest thing is we might leave the money to the children, whatever, okay? I think one of the most valuable things that we could really leave to our posterity is really not capital. It's actually how you got the capital. What were some of the strategies you were using, some of the tactics, what were some of the plans that we were using, et cetera. I think that is one of the most valuable things outside the money because, well, if you give someone money, they don't know how you did it. Now, as always, what we like to do, and we'll show you where you can get this, you can print out a sample investing plan. We're going to kind of talk through some of the key elements of this and then do some application of it. I'm going to tell you right now, I have friends of mine I've known for 25 plus years in investing, and some of them don't even have an investing plan. They know it's important, but they don't have a plan, okay? I know some of the people that, for example, have a plan, and I tend to do notice a common denominator. Those who tend to have plans tend to be more consistent, routine-oriented, more disciplined, et cetera. I'm not saying who had higher returns or not. I'm just saying you tend to notice some common denominators by having one, okay? Now, and also practice the use of it. And a lot of times as people, they say, I'd like to invest, but I don't really know what to do or how to practice. The plan itself is telling you or showing you, walking you through how you could practice and evolve your own plan. So without further ado, where do we get that? Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring up, first off, as I mentioned, you can go to this playlist, and Lee sent that out. Thank you so much for that. You're going to notice that this is the sample playlist, or I should say playlist itself, and you're going to see that over to the right-hand side, these were the past classes. Now, you're going to see that starting with lesson one right there, last week, lesson two, what do price multiples tell you? There you go. Today will be lesson number three. I will label them as such so you know, okay? Now, the biggest thing is we want to get into now is we want to go to the Schwab website. Now, if we log in, okay, to the schwab.com website, you're going to see that up at the very top, it's going to say learn. Okay. And I want to say something right now. If you asked me and said, James, what's the most important thing of investing? Is it like support? Is it resistance? Is it an indicator? Is it a stock ticker? I would say it's really, those are pieces. Okay. But really the picture of the puzzle is that sample plan. Okay. To me, that tells me how far you really are. It's not how many years you're in the market. It's do you have a plan? That really tells me the maturity and the understanding of really what you're doing, okay? And give yourself a chance for crying out loud. And also, I want to kind of say it like this. If you are going to build $1 million, $2 million home, do you think you're literally just going to build it off a napkin? Really? Okay, no. You're going to have a plan, and it's going to be well thought out. And you want to think about this, your capital is going to be probably more than that $1 or $2 million that you're probably going to have for your pension slash lifestyle. Okay. So with that said, let's go ahead and get started. We're going to go to learn. We're going to go to where it says courses. And once we do that, you're now going to see as we scroll down, it'll say simple steps for retirement portfolio, stock investing with fundamental analysis. The whole goal of the fundamental analysis is you really have an understanding of what is it that you're actually buying. Okay. If I click on that stock investing with fundamental analysis, going to click on it, we have the lessons broken down. Just real quick, we're going to go to where it says learn, okay, courses. Once we do go there, go two down, you're going to see the fundamental analysis course. That's how we got to where we are. If you scroll down now, okay, you're now going to see if we scroll down, it's going to show, it will say resources. And it'll say stocks investing with fundamental analysis, value sample plan, and it will say the intrinsic value calculator. Today, we will be using both an application of this sample investing plan, okay? Now, what I want to do is I want to go ahead and just click on this, okay? And it's a PDF. So I'm going to click on that, and now what you're going to notice is here's that sample plan. Some quick disclosures. This plan is really provided for informational purposes only. It's really showing an example of what a plan could be. When you understand that really this plan, it really, the purpose of it is how you might build your own plan best fit for whose investing style? Yours, okay? But the principles are gonna be here, some of the practices, but you might kind of add some things and take some things away. Noted, and I did as well, okay? Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna zoom in on this so that way we're gonna just see it. So first off, when we take a look at this fundamental value sample plan, the biggest thing is the objective here is we're trying to invest in stocks that appear fundamentally strong, okay? Now, when I saw that the first time, I was like, what does that mean? That can mean different things to different people. So I want to kind of touch upon some words because when we do the application, you're going to know why we're focusing on the stocks we are. So if you said to me fundamentally strong, I think that the company has cash. Okay, and that cash is growing. So they're in a good financial position. Number two, they have revenues that are not stale or stagnant. They're growing. Two, the earnings is growing. Four, that the dividends, maybe they pay a dividend or they're increasing the dividend over time in relationship to the earnings increasing. Five, I like to also see a stock where maybe it's one of the top stocks in the industry group. I mean, do you really want to buy the bottom of the barrel? Good. Okay. Those would be kind of some of the things I think about fundamentally strong. And the biggest thing is that maybe they're priced equal to or lower than their intrinsic value. Okay. Now, some of the big thing is when it says, learn how to invest in stocks. What are we talking about? I think when we're talking about this class is trade and invest. Okay. I think maybe when we talk about trade, it'd probably be like maybe over 2 to 3 week time frame. If we're talking about investing in these stocks, we're probably talking about maybe an idea of minimum, potentially 2 to 3 months minimum, assuming they don't go down and break support. Okay. Now, when we talk about, for example, watch list criteria, okay, what are some of the filters we're going to use to try to find some of these stocks? Well, on the back of what we talked about last week, we talked about price multiples. We could use that as a filter to try to find some of these stocks that have potential value, or are some of these stocks that have some stronger fundamentals. Okay. Now, if we take a look at this, we talked about PE last week, and the number that we're going to change this to for our examples is, before we run a quick screen, is really 15 to 30. Now, notice I am putting a number of 15 to 30. The reason why I'm doing that is if you get a PE too low, well, it might be a little awkward that it's not even at 15. When you see a lot of energy companies, they have like PEs of like 5, 8, 10, really low. A lot of investors are not comfortable to really buy those stocks if they feel like their earnings is all over the place. We're looking for something that has a little bit more consistency, and where investors are willing to push the price up in support of its trailing earnings. Very important point. Price to book, we're not going to talk about too much. When we talk about book, we need really fair values that are identifiable in the current marketplace. When we talk about price to book, that's usually financial stocks where you could actually see what are those assets and are they traded to see the values. Price to sales, we will use. We're going to look for something 6 or lower. Remember, sales, another word for revenue. We're going to look for something 6 or lower. Now, return on equity, something, again, very important, 10 or higher. When we talk about return on equity, we're saying net income over equity, okay? And it's saying if the shareholder invests a dollar, the company generates 10 cents or higher in profit. So they're not sitting on the capital. They're investing the capital, and they're getting a return for that. Very important. Second to last one here is when we talk about debt to equity ratio. We would like low debt and a higher amount of equity. And the volume there, we would definitely push up to, let's say, 1 million shares or higher. Okay. Now, are there any questions here? Now, guys and gals, now remember what I kind of said. One day when you give your plan to your son or daughter, it's very important. They're going to ask you, well, how did you do what you did? And say, you know, I never got around to do that. I think one of the most valuable things is you could give them that sample plan. Now, I have a couple of them. Okay. They're right upstairs. Put them in a little binder. I leave them right on my desk. Okay. And I kind of tend to like them. Okay. Now, here we go. So I want to now go to, for example, we're going to go right up to the very tippy top. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go to at the very top where it says research. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go to stocks. You got to start with a basic search, right? If I go to research and then say stocks, you're now going to see where it's going to say stock screener. Okay, so this isn't too bad, right? Research, stocks. Now, the biggest thing is do not feel like, man, I got to be a search master. I think people probably spend too much time searching. I think a lot of times the diamonds are right below people's feet, but they're constantly searching all over the place. Now, what I want to do is I want to kind of specify something and be very crystal clear. When we show examples, at least I do in this class, in my classes, I can't speak for other coaches, but 95% of all of our examples come from the Dow 30 stocks that are within there. The NASDAQ 100, the stocks that are within that NASDAQ, and the S&P 100. Probably 5% or less come from the S&P 500. So we don't look at 12, 14,000 stocks. We're looking at a list of really 230 stocks or less, even less than that, because some are on the same indexes. Now, so our list is even smaller. And the reason why we do that is we're trying to find the companies that maybe already have, that are really mid to larger cap and also have volume. Now, what you're going to notice on this left-hand side, it's going to say basic, dividends, et cetera. Let's click on where it says basic. Now, the first thing I want to do is the two easiest way to screen things, that's probably the most appropriate, is start off with price, okay? price tells you about a lot in terms of what do investors think of it. And also it probably tells you something about the style, or I should say the categorization of the capitalization. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to look for stocks that are greater than $40. Okay. So I clicked on price. We're now going to go to where it says 40 to 60. Okay. Now, when I did that, what you're going to notice is I'm going to just click on where it says enter specified values. I'm just going to say 40. Okay. What you're going to notice is when you get stocks below $40, geez, you kind of wonder, like, are they going to, like, some of them can make it, but the fact that they get below 40 is not necessarily great. Okay. Now, could they come back up? Sure. But we would like to at least see stocks at least above 40. Okay. Now, number two, we're going to go over where it says market capitalization. And what we're going to do in this case is we're going to click on that and we're going to click on mid cap and large cap. I don't know if you've seen this, but we tend to like those larger cap stocks. Okay. There's reasons for that. Okay. Now mine is showing it's kind of circling here. Okay. There we go. There we go. Now it's loaded. There you go. Now, second thing I want to kind of bring up is when we click on basic, is there anything else? Now we could do sectors and industries, et cetera. Okay. We could do that. I also want to, for example, come down and say upcoming earnings. Okay. This is very important. If we're looking maybe for values, sometimes stocks can sell off prior to the earnings. We want to kind of put maybe the next 30 days or so. Okay. Now, the other thing I want to kind of mention here is when I take a look at this, if I went down to, let's say, the valuation itself on the left-hand side, we're going to actually put on the, where it says valuation, we're going to actually put the PE right there, click on that, and we're going to put a number. And what was the number on PE again? What was the number on PE? Well, we actually said the PE that we were going to use was really between 15 and 30. But let's go ahead and put that there. So if I did 15 and 30, I'm going to click on just 30 to 40. It doesn't matter because I can say enter specified values. If I do that, I'm going to put 15 to 30. Now, next week when we talk about really growth, what you're going to notice is we might come across some stocks that have a lot higher multiples. That's true, okay? But for what we're looking at right now, we want something kind of more in the value categorization. Now, the other thing I want to kind of do is that I did not, is I'm also going to include right here when I go back up, I need to also put in where it says basic. One thing that we could include, and I said there's two things that matter probably the most, the stock price and volume. We're going to go back and we're going to click on volume. We said we want to at least see a million or higher. We're going to click on enter specific values, click. And just put, let's say, 1 million. It's always hard to see how many zeros you have. Okay, there you go. Now, some investors, and Eva's one of them, maybe, who likes dividends, likes yields. They're like, why would I buy a stock if they're not going to pay me anything? Well, good point, okay? We're going to click on dividends. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to say annual dividend yield. I'm just going to throw in a number here. If we want to include that, let's just say between 2 to 3%. Or we could just say anything above 2%, okay? Now, let's just take a quick step back here. What was the number one thing we actually said was super important? What's the stock price, okay? Number one. Number two was the volume itself. Capitalization, looking for some mid to larger caps, okay? Price to earnings, which we already said, 15 to 30, and annual dividend yield. So out of the whole universe, we got 49 stocks that come back. Let's see what we have. But you know, one thing I want to kind of say is about people that poo-poo dividends. It always makes me wonder if people don't like dividends, if they have ever gotten any. Because when you see sometimes, if you have a couple hundred shares of stock and you get a dividend, even if you're not really super interested in dividend, you're like, dadgummit, that would, okay, I'm not going to give it back, right? Now, a lot of people say, I wouldn't give it back. So, you know, just kind of be aware of that. Be careful about poo-pooing dividends. You just might not have enough shares yet to see the magnitude of those, and especially over something over time. Now, here's some of the stocks that we actually get back that we're going to mention. You got ADP, AE, Amgen, which has been on a pretty good tear, okay? You get another stock in here. You got CME, you got Dow, you got Duke. Now notice what type of neighborhoods we're seeing, okay? General Dynamics, Gilead, Honeywell, Hershey, IBM, JCI, etc. That's page one. Now, if we scroll forward here, now what you're going to see is some of these other ones. Now, when we kind of threw on the dividend, you're going to see that some of these companies, they're in the staples, they're in the utilities, they're in the healthcare, they're in the industrials, etc. Now, some of these are financials. Some of these right above where I'm pointing, they're in real estate. Okay, so it's not like we're just in one sector, etc. We even have Starbucks in there. Now we're talking about discretionaries and or staples. Now, what I would like to do is I would kind of like to take one of these stocks that I found from before about an hour ago, and let's kind of talk about one of these. Okay, let's kind of talk about it from the standpoint of once we have this sample plan, there we go. What is it that the investor is really looking for to consider an entry? So we talked about what is the watchlist criteria, okay, running the search. Now we're going to look at some of the stocks that are in that list. And then, now, by the way, there is not one search. You can kind of change those a little bit and get different stocks. That's okay. We're just looking for candidates, okay? We're not looking for Mr. or Mrs. Perfect because they don't exist. We're just looking for candidates. And then once we have those candidates to fit the criteria, then we're going to ask ourselves now, what would be those sample entry rules? Now, I want to kind of talk about this, okay? Now, if we're talking about something like value, when we think of like value, it's probably going to be a lot of stocks that had a prior high that maybe pulled back, based itself, and then started going back up. That's pretty normal, okay? When you see value, what's creating the value? It's when the price drops in the short term. That does not mean the trend is going down, okay? It might be going down in the short term, but overall, we might see a long-term trend, but maybe there's been a consolidation of this upward trend. What the investor is trying to do is trying to buy in a pullback in an uptrend over time. Okay, and they're trying to use that short-term price falling or volatility to try to buy the dip, okay, of the stock price. Now, the other thing I want to kind of make mention here is when we talk about what about these entry rules, okay? So first off, when we look at these entry rules, entries, I don't care if you talk about the CCR, RSI, Awesome Indicator, whatever, the Arunic, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. They all come down to three main things. What are those main things? It's called a bounce, okay, bounce. It's called a breakout. I'll label it as a BO. And you could just kind of label this really as, and I'll label this as an MAX. So when I think about all these different entries, they all funnel down into three. That's it, okay? Now, you could say certain indicators gave you a setup, but at the end of the day, it comes into these three baskets. Was it a bounce off support? Was it a BO, a breakout? Or third, was it a moving average crossover? So whether we're talking about a value plan or a growth plan, I don't care if you use certain indicators or whatever you like to use, it's coming back to these three things. Be a master of these three things. So when it talks about a breakout of a basing pattern, that's what they're talking about. Now, if you get a breakout of a basing pattern, could it also be a bounce too? Yes, but if you get a breakout of a basing pattern, it's probably really a moving average crossover as well, okay? Now, when it talks about off a 200-period moving average, okay? Now, this is kind of, it might be different for different people. Some investors don't like to look at stocks down a 200-period moving average. The fact that it fell down that far might be a red flag, okay? So when we look at the moving averages, we're going to look at like a 10-20 moving average or maybe a 10-30 moving average. Those are the combination. If we said, what's the lowest moving average, or I should say, what's the highest moving average we will use for this class? We'll use a 50-period moving average. But I will not be talking too much about a 200 period moving average because that implies that the stock has gone down quite a bit and there might be technical damage on the chart. Okay. And that just means that the stock has fallen down quite a bit. We're trying to find some stocks that have had stronger strength and or trend. Now, are there any questions? Okay. Now, I want to kind of go back to this and see if there's any plans, any questions about the plan. And if I didn't see it, go ahead and send it back to me. But what I like to do right now is I'm going to bring up one of the stocks that I saw from before, and we are going to bring it up on the Thinkorswim platform. And this is really one of the stocks that came up early on the list that I want to kind of discuss, the CBOE. Now, remember one of my comments from before is, when people think value, they always think, oh yeah, the stock has to be like beaten down. That's not true, okay? What you're gonna notice is the stock had an upward trend, made a brand new high, and in the shorter term, it pulled back. Now, if I zoom in on the right-hand side here, we do see that it kind of created a base of support. So when you say that base of support, is there any length of time you would say to say it's basing? 2 to 3 weeks minimum? 2 to 3 months, that would kind of be like a nice time frame. And if we start to see, let's say it started to break out of an area of resistance, right? Well, that would be that we're getting out of that basing area between support and resistance, and now we're starting to retrend back to the upside potentially, right? And so I want to kind of talk about this. Now, 2 weeks ago, we talked about identifying its intrinsic value, okay? So in other words, if you're going to buy a house, you're kind of probably going to be looking at price per square foot. If you're going to buy a car, right, you might kind of say, what are you asking? You're going to compare it to other dealerships, other cities and states, and just to kind of see if you're getting a deal or if you're kind of being taken to the cleaners, which I couldn't imagine, okay? But let's just say that happened. Now, what I want to do is I want to kind of bring back up that sheet, okay? Now, what I want to do is I want to kind of talk about this, and let's kind of look at some examples to see if we can execute. So it's not about having a plan solely. It's about, can you execute the plan? You know what I've noticed? It's usually not the plan. It's usually me that kind of messes up the plan. Have you ever done that yourself? Okay, I think we've all been there. Now, the example that I'm going to use to start with, we're going to start down at the bottom. Now, you might be kind of wondering, where is this? Well, if we kind of go right back to the Schwab website, and remember when we were on resources and we've been working on that sample investing plan? Well, right down below that, it's going to say intrinsic value calculator. Okay, so there it is. And you can just click on it and it's going to come up. Now, this is not new. We've talked about this past 2 weeks. But now what I want to do is I want to execute the plan that we have outlaid here. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at what's the stock price. Okay. Now, if we kind of said, well, what is the stock price? I got a stock price at 187.13. Okay. 187.13. Whoop. 187.13. So that's not too bad. So think of this sheet. It's a worksheet. Okay. Now, notice what it's going to ask us here. What's the stock's earnings per share? Well, we want to, where do we find that information? Well, we're going to go right back to the Schwab website. And what you're going to see is if I type in CBOE, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to where it says research tools. Okay. I'm going to click on where it says stock compare. Okay. Now, when we do this, what I'm going to do is it's going to show us, let me show that again. Type in the symbol, CBOE, okay? Not too bad. Research tools. Once I click on research tools, stock compare, okay? Now, once we get there, what you're going to notice is we can populate the competitors. Who's in this space that the CBO is also in? Now, when you scroll down, what you're now going to notice is we can see information about the company itself. We are in column number one. When we scroll down, you're going to see things like the fundamentals. margins, return on equity. Didn't we talk about a number of 10 or higher? Yes, we did. When we look at the PE, what do we have in terms of the PE? It's at 27. Does that meet the criteria between 15 or 30? I think it does. When we take a look at the price of sales, we said 6 or lower. Does it meet the criteria? It does. So we're looking at, does this match what was in the plan? Okay. Now what I'm going to do is when I scroll down, you're going to see information such as the annual growth of sales, earnings growth, etc. Now we need some of this information. Like what information? Well, first thing what we need is we really need the earnings per share. Okay. Where do we find that earnings per share? Ah, right there. Okay. So we need this number. We need 664. What I'm going to do with that information, I'm going to type it in right there, 664. We said in the last 2 weeks, we're going to keep this to 2 years of projected growth. Okay. Now, when we talked about cap, and when we talked about cap M, now you might be wondering, James, I'm not familiar with cap M. Cap M stands for capital asset pricing model. The capital asset pricing model uses beta, the risk-free rate or 10-year yield or 30-year yield, and also the market expected return. Who cares? Well, the reason why we care, that CAPM percent is what they discount the dividends by, the earnings per share by, the free cash flows by, to get an idea of what the company should be worth in today's dollars. So that's why it matters, okay? So we're not doing CAPM just kind of this way, oh, yeah, let's take a random number. This percent is what the cash flows, earnings per share, dividends, free cash flow is discounted by to see what it's worth today. Discounting is one of the most foundational concepts in finance, okay? Now, you might say, I've never heard of that before. You have to. Someone wins a huge payout, a $100 million payout, and they say, hey, you can get $100 million over 20 years, or you could get $50 million today. Wait, where'd the other 50 go? Well, they're discounting it back to today, okay? They're using basic laws of finance. Now, the other thing we want to kind of look at here is what's that earnings per share growth rate? This is very important. We're not looking for companies that have erratic earnings per share growth. We want kind of something that has more stability, okay? Earnings per share growth rate, where do we find that? What you're now going to see is when you see, look at earnings per share growth rate, as we scroll back down on that left-hand side, we're looking at the last 5 years. Now, what you're going to notice is it's only 2.78. That's not a lot, as you're going to see in other examples we'll look at. We're going to type in 2.78. And when we look at the sector PE on the current year, okay, when we pull it back up, where do we find that? You're now going to see, if I scroll back up, we're going to do index comparison. If I click on where it says index comparison, why does these things even matter? Well, now what you're going to see is we're going to see SIBO, its PE, the industry group PE, and the S&P PE, okay? So when you look at the stock of SIBO, it's actually more expensive than the industry group and index. We're going to type in 2766 and let's see what we have now. Okay. Now, when we scroll down to the bottom, okay, now what you're going to notice is, now you need to understand this, good and bad. Now, when we have full context next week with, for example, and I need to double check one thing on this because we did not hit it, but let's see if we can't, I just have to check one thing. The last thing we really need on there is beta. I'm just double checking it, okay? And the way we got down to beta is we just scrolled down to the bottom on the stock information, and you're going to see that I'm just looking for their beta 0.6. Okay, we put that back right there, and we should be good to go. All right, now, so first off, it's going to show us, based upon its current fundamentals, based upon what's built into the model, what should that stock be worth, okay, given its current fundamentals and assumptions? $146. The current stock price is $187.13, okay? So if we take a look at this, If we buy the stock at $187.13, but the actual value is showing 146, we're really paying a premium above what its intrinsic value is. Now, that doesn't mean it's bad. It just kind of means it's probably more of a growth candidate. Does that make sense? Now, I want to kind of start this one off on purpose because sometimes when you do this, you're like, dang, I mean, I had a really nice stock. But for example, it seems like it's a little bit more of growth than value. That's okay. Because next week when you see that plane of growth, you're going to say, well, I could just use this in growth. That's why we talk about both. Okay? Now, the biggest thing is if we take a look at this, you're now going to see that the goal of what the investor is really trying to do is they're trying to find something that's trading at the intrinsic value or below its intrinsic value. Okay? Now, what we would like to find, now let me kind of do this. Let me play with the numbers to kind of show you. If I said, hey, this stock is actually $136.32, it's now trading at a positive margin of safety. What does that mean? It means the stock price is trading below its intrinsic value. Okay? Now, why do we want like a margin or a band? Well, because in a model, there's assumptions that are built in. We like to find something that might have a 10% margin of safety to account for assumptions, just in case maybe some things are high or they don't go as planned. And that's what you do in life, okay? So what I want to do is this would be more of an example of growth. And if you look at this, when you kind of pull up this chart, if you see a stock hitting a 52-week high, that's a pretty good indication that it's actually probably a growth stock. Now, I did this at first because when you look at a stock like this, you always think it's overpriced. But when you looked at the multiples that we talked about, that was not true. Okay? Now, let me show you one that would be more of a value candidate. Okay, I didn't want to tease you forever. But, okay, here we go. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to slide this over so we can kind of do this a little faster here. I'm going to bring up the example of AMAT, okay? Now, if you look at AMAT, this has kind of been something that has gone up, down, up, down. And sometimes when you see value, you might see these. Now, when we look at actually this stock, we might be thinking, well, AMAT's gone up and down. We had old support down here, but then we have new support level potentially up here. Now, if we're talking about value, is that a bad sign or a good sign? I don't think it's a bad sign. If we go back and take a 3-year weekly chart, that chart overall has been going up. Guys and gals, this is exactly what we're talking about. You see a prior high, it fell down, and then it started to go up over time, and it created higher support levels over time. That's a welcome sight for a value investor. Now, let's run the numbers, okay? So first off, what's the stock price? 153.37. What do we got here? 153.37. I'm going to go back to this. So when I pull this up, now don't worry, I'm going to slide the sheet over it in just a moment. We're looking at AMAT. Just looking for beta down at the bottom. And what do we got? Beta 1.56. Okay. Now, we need the earnings per share for the stock. Going right back to this beta, AMAT, excuse me. We're going right back to what we saw before. AMAT, we're going to scroll down. PE is what? 18. Okay. Price to sales, 4.82. Looking fine so far. Okay. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to need to go back to this company comparison, scroll down. And what we're looking for in this case is what's the earnings per share? What do we got? It's 8.11. So I'm going to type that in. Now, don't worry, I'm going to slide it over in just a sec. But there is one thing I want to show you. Okay. One of the things I said last week and the week before, one of the common denominators that would probably give you an idea that this is probably trading at a discount, if you see a higher earnings per share relative to the stock price, that is a very interesting setup. That's called earnings yield. That means the stock could be more supported by its current trailing earnings. That's not a bad thing, okay? Now, let's finish this up. As I kind of move this over very carefully, okay, Now I'm going to bring up what's that? What's the earnings per share growth rate? I was right there. The earnings per share growth rate, when we look at this over the last 5 years, now notice this, 14.94. Now, would that be a good thing or a bad thing? Is having higher growth good or bad? Oh my gosh. If you have higher growth, and that might be forecasted to continue, if it was, that wouldn't be a bad thing. It would increase the intrinsic value. Last thing we need to actually put up is what's the PE. Let's click on index comparison. And you're now going to see the PE for the group is 42.7. Now, notice some difference here, and I'm doing this on purpose. On the previous example, we saw that SIBO is higher than the industry and the index. Here, the stock is lower than the S&P, the sector itself. It's lower than the index as well. So is that bad? Well, maybe could this be something else where the investor could be saying there's potential value? About ready to show you, okay? 18.95. Now, James, you've been, hung us out there as long as possible. Show us the numbers. Okay, so here it is. So now what you're going to notice is we see that the intrinsic value is really 133.74, stock price 153.37, margin of safety, okay, 14.7. Now, here's what I'm going to tell you. You as an investor could create your own criteria. I'm going to tell you the numbers that we like to use for ourselves, okay? When we look at these numbers, the things that we like to see is, let me kind of erase that. We like to see numbers where there you have something where it has a positive margin of safety of 20%. What does that mean? That means the stock price is trading lower than the intrinsic value. Second, you're trading at, let's say, up to a negative margin of safety of 20%. Because if you have a stock that, let's say, example given, is in the, let's say, technology space like AMAT, those stocks are, on a majority basis, are probably not going to be trading in a bull market at a discount to intrinsic value. Why? Well, because there tends to be more growth implied in the potential future. That doesn't mean they're going to hit it, but investors are pushing up the price. So in our examples, we're going to look for something that has 20% positive margin of safety up to negative 20. So that means that for this portfolio, we're willing to pay a little premium above its intrinsic value. Now you might say, James, I would never do that. That's fine. That's why you have your plan. You might say, I'm always looking for something where the intrinsic value and the stock price at the worst would be the same, or I'm seeing the stock price lower than the intrinsic value. That's fine. I'm just telling you what we're doing, okay? So in this example, now when we come to growth stocks more next week, you're going to see more stocks that have a higher negative margin of safety, and we'll talk about what that really implies currently, and what's the risk going forward of that. But now we at least know, kind of have an idea of what that stock potentially might be worth. Now, what we're going to do is going to go back. We're going to take that plan that we actually brought up. How do we actually put in that sample plan? How do we actually do that? Now, I'm going to bring back up, going to go to the trade tab. Now, one of the three things we actually said in rounding it out here, we talked about a bounce. We talked about a moving average crossover, and we talked about a breakout. Well, if you kind of see recently what we have, this was a moving average crossover. We can see it right where my pencil is. We can also see an identifiable support right around 148, okay? Now, what I'm going to do in this case is I'm gonna just going to right-click right on the chart. Right-click right on the chart. We're going to go to where it says buy custom. And we're going to go right to where it says with stop. Okay. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take where that support area is, right about 148 and a quarter. Okay. And set a stop 2 to 3% below that. In our case, we'll do 2%. And if we do that, we're going to set a stop at 145.28. 145.28, stop day GTC. Okay. Now, your homework assignment is just like I did, okay? I want you to print out that sample plan. I want you to kind of think back to, like, what are you currently doing? And then, for example, think about what is it maybe that you've learned, and how do you want to invest? Not that it's perfect, but it's, for example, things that you're trying to implement, principles and practice going forward. What have you seen that's worked? What's not worked? Then keep those things off the plan. And this kind of aligns you to your routine and being disciplined. A lot of people don't know how to be disciplined because there's no routine to actually focus on. Very important. Now, what I'd like you to do is practice finding 2 to 3 stocks that meet your own criteria. If you say, James, could I use the ones that we looked at today, like the sample criteria? Absolutely. Practice running the search. Now, next week in closing here, we will be also talking about a sample growth investing plan. The nice thing about knowing both is if we find a stock like SIBO that does not meet the value criteria, that does not mean what we just did was a waste of stinking time. We could actually say, hey, this I could now just go over to my growth plan, and could I execute that potentially on a growth plan basis? Okay. So this is what's kind of exciting when you don't just pigeonhole yourself to one plan, that's it, but kind of have a dual plan of value and growth. Now, I'm out of my time here today. I want to thank Lee for answering those questions in chat. I also want to make mention, if you have not subscribed to this Trader Talks channel on YouTube by Schwab Coaching, do so now. It's free. Okay, all you got to do is click subscribe. When you click on subscribe, you're going to see all of our content right on YouTube. And then with that content, what you're going to notice is we also have playlist as well. And so what you're going to notice is when you click on this, you're going to see this is what our page will look like. And we have videos, live classes, playlists. It's all at your fingertips. You do not have to be sitting at your computer. You could be on a mobile device, whatever. Okay. You could be in Spain. You could be in Ecuador, like myself, whatever. Okay. That's the nice thing is you can get this information whenever you want. It's posted there for you. Remember, next week, what we'll do is we'll focus on the growth plan. And then also with that is with what we discussed here today. Remember that the information was mentioned for general informational purposes only. Gave you a homework assignment. Practice building that sample plan. And this has really been the class on the lesson 3 of trading growth and value stocks with the sample value plan. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.